I'm really excited we got a chance to catch up with Professor Tracey Holloway from the University of Wisconsin. Tracey works at the intersection of climate change, air pollution, and human health, and thinks about how we have to change up the whole energy system in order to address all three of those issues.
Well, hey, Tracey, it's so good to see you, and welcome to our little class here. Really appreciate you coming on to talk to us. I wanted to maybe begin by asking you, as an atmospheric scientist, somebody who's thinking about meteorology and climate change and atmospheric chemistry more than about any of us, to really tell us what worries you about climate change these days. What are some of the signs you're seeing or things that you see that are kind of troubling right now?
Yeah, well, so nice to see you, John, and great to be part of this class. Certainly, the climate crisis is something that we're dealing with in a way that no generation has had to face before. The problems that are leading to our current climate problem have been around since the Industrial Revolution, when we started burning fossil fuels for energy. But it's taken a long time for carbon dioxide levels in the atmosphere to build up to the point that they're really noticeably affecting the temperature of the air, the growing seasons, how hot the summers get, precipitation patterns. And all the changes we're seeing are consistent with predictions that have been around for decades. Since the earliest climate models, and even hundreds of years ago, when they were thinking about the net global effect of CO2 in the atmosphere, the prediction had been that temperatures would warm and the global climate system, about how we live and what storms are like and what seasons are like, all of these things are dependent on this balance of the global climate. And so, you know, since I was in graduate school, people have been saying to me, you know, what do you think about climate change? You know, what do you think about it? And for a long time, you know, I just was sharing what the scientific community was seeing, which was, you know, CO2 is increasing. We know CO2 warms the planet. And so we expect the planet to be getting warmer. But really, over the past couple of decades since I've been a professor at the University of Wisconsin, now we see with our eyes and our pocketbooks, oftentimes in terms of the devastation of these climate changes, the impact of climate. So, you know, I think that this is something that a lot of people have trouble kind of internalizing, because we can't smell CO2 and we don't see CO2 and we can't even, you know, exactly say whether one storm occurred because of climate change. But when you look at the patterns of what's happening in the US and around the world, they're totally consistent with what scientists have been predicting for decades. So there's really no question that change is happening, and we know what the problem is. It's elevated levels of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases into the atmosphere.
Yeah, it's funny. It's like, I'd really like to believe that people are finally listening to the scientists. I think people are listening to Mother Nature, really, more than anything. It's like, oh, wow, this is getting real. And, you know, like when I began grad school earlier than you, I was like, oh, you know, this is like, seemed like, you know, this distant future, the year 2020. Ooh. I'm like, oh, crap, here we are. And the world's just about as predicted in terms of at least large scale climate changes. You're right. I mean, you know, even Arrhenius, the end of the 19th century, was making calculations that are kind of like spot on still today. But now we have much richer tools to kind of look at what's happening to the seasons and the intensities of storms, or like nighttime warming versus daytime and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, sadly, and this is what a lot of people don't realize, the scientists would be very happy to have been wrong. I would much rather have a perfectly safe planet and a little egg on my face, but like, yeah. you know, this is not a conspiracy to make scientists look good. You know, we don't want that. It turns out like, hey, the planet's changing and it's bad news. But you work on the intersection, it's a very interesting background. If, you know, you are an atmospheric scientist, but you also work on like energy systems and policy issues, but also at the confluence of like air quality, which affects human health like immediately, and climate change and energy. So I'd really love to ask you kind of where you see this nexus of your expertise, kind of where do you see some opportunities for solutions to roll out and make a big difference? Where do we see the most exciting things we can do?
Yeah, well, you know, first I'll say I'm really an optimist. And I think that there's no way to get up and go to work every morning, at least for me, if I didn't feel like this was a problem that had a solution and that we could learn not just from our mistakes, but also learn from our successes. And to me, one of the greatest successes is the United States Clean Air Act of 1970. Before 1970, air pollution across the United States in small towns that had local manufacturing facilities and other sources, and big cities filled with cars and trucks, air pollution was getting worse and worse and worse. I had one colleague who was a professor in Boston who said that some days he couldn't look across the Charles River because the pollution in Boston was so bad. And you know, if you Google photos of smog in different years, holy cow, you can see these crazy images of that look like a big cloud sitting over cities. And it doesn't just look bad and smell bad, but you can really see that more people die on the days when air pollution is high and more kids check into the hospital with asthma attacks on the days that ozone is high. And so there's these acute problems for public health and known issues about acid deposition and degrading crops and a lot of other problems with chemicals in the air that react with our lungs, with our eyes, with plants and cause direct damage. But the good news is that back in 1970, they realized this too. And this was the year the EPA was formed. And it was the year the Clean Air Act was implemented. And immediately after this decision on the part of the nation to take action, then all of a sudden, the emissions of these chemicals into the air started going down. And the measured concentrations in the air started going down. The deposition of acid rain started going down. Everything started going down. And public health experts have been able to parse the data in fancy ways and figure out that we're living longer because we have this clean air. So, you know, when I think about air pollution, yes, there are many parts of the United States that are still unhealthy to live in. And around the world, it's a big issue. But this is something where we made a decision in 1970 and that turned the switch. All of a sudden, every major regulated chemical started getting cleaner in the air. And so when I think about the climate problem, I feel confident that when that same decision is made, we can take action right away. And CO2 is very different than other pollutants, and we can talk about that. But we also have so many technologies to solve the carbon emission problem on the shelf, just sitting there, not yet fully deployed, as you know. And so, you know, I think one of the issues is to know that we've done this before for pretty much every other air pollutant that you can think of. And it's just a matter of the national will and making the policies to incentivize us using technologies that already exist.
That's such a great point. And thanks. It's a really, really, I think we forget the kind of successes we've had in the environmental kind of movement, if you will, especially in the early 70s, ironically, when we had a Republican president, Richard Nixon, which, you know, wasn't as polarized back then. So we had big wins back then. Now, as you pointed out, you know, those kind of chemicals in the air had a more immediate, visible, visceral impact on public health. We could, you know, it affected you directly right now. CO2 is a little bit more subtle. It's invisible. We can't actually see it, feel it, taste it, smell it. I mean, wouldn't it be great if CO2 messed with our cell phones or something? We would solve that problem right now. You know, like, oh my God, it's messing with 4G. I got to fix it, you know. But it's not the case. It's going to mess with the kind of longer term balance of energy flowing in and out of the planet, making the lower atmosphere warmer and changing our weather patterns. But so it's a little different. But your point is the same. It's like, you know, this is, we don't have to invent new technologies to make this happen. In fact, we just have to kind of let go of some old technologies and replace them with things we, like you say, have on the shelf. So, you know, what are some of the most limiting factors, do you think, from, you know, to bring those new systems to scale and to kind of move aside from the old ones? Like you pointed out, we've done it before, but how do we do it this time?
Well, you know, one thing I found in talking to students and the public is that, first of all, people don't appreciate the differences between carbon dioxide and all these other chemicals. And the biggest difference is that all these other chemicals are reactive. They react with our lungs and our eyes, but they also react in the atmosphere with each other. So they have a much shorter lifetime, maybe hours or days, as opposed to CO2, which is decades or centuries. And that reactivity has allowed us to put in technology controls on power plants and cars. You know, one example is the catalytic converter. It's just an instrument. They put it on a car and boom, you have less carbon monoxide coming out the tailpipe. There are no technology controls like that for CO2. It's more of a switching of the system. But there's lots of ways to switch the system. And, you know, sometimes naysayers, I think, focus on carbon controls as a, like, depriving us of what we want to eat or depriving us of where we want to live. But actually, a lot of the solutions we can't even see. For example, where our electricity comes from. You know, you switch on a switch, the light comes on, or you use your computer. And where those little electrons are being generated, most people don't know or really care where they're coming from. And even right now, it changes depending on where you are in the United States. Like the Pacific Northwest gets a lot of electricity from hydropower, whereas other places get much more from coal and natural gas. But there are sources of electricity that emit nothing into the atmosphere, including nuclear, which is already widely deployed, solar energy, wind energy, and, you know, new technologies like tidal energy. That's a little more technology emergence side. But solar at this point has been getting cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. So the things that maybe a few years ago, a couple decades ago, might have seemed very costly, and I think a lot of people in their minds still think of them like, oh gosh, that would be so expensive, aren't going to be expensive like that anymore. And the other thing I would say is cars. You know, when we drive around in vehicles, for the most part, we burn liquid fuel. And if you fill your car up with gasoline and drive for 100 miles and have an empty tank, all of that went into one place, which is the air. Yep. Where that's right. So there's really no question that the carbon from your gas tank went into the air because you have to fill up your gas tank again. Whereas electric vehicles are great. You don't have to fill them up with gas. You don't have to keep paying at the gas tank. And there's some charging stations. We actually got an electric car a few months ago, and you can charge it so quickly. I mean, just in the time that it takes to pull up, plug in, and do the same kind of like pit stops that you might do at a regular gas station, your car's already charged and ready to keep driving. So, you know, I think that the way we're living today is not a huge way to change. We don't need to change the way we're living today dramatically to reduce carbon dramatically. Change the cars, change the electricity, change some of our home heating technology, and boom, I think we could really make a huge cut in our nation's and our personal carbon footprint.
Yeah, that's the thing. Is so, well, there's two really good points you just made right there too. One is that, you know, it isn't the stuff we own that matters as much as the service it provides. Like, you know, again, you know, I don't really care where the electrons come from in my house. I just want the lights to turn on. I want my, you know, my iPhone to work. I want to be able to charge my computer. But if that's provided by the sun or a coal power plant, it doesn't make a difference in the quality of my Netflix binge watching or something, you know, whatever. It's going to work either way, right? The other thing is that so many of the solutions to this are things that are going to be obviously good for us, like taking an old leaky house with windows that aren't working very well, or, you know, you're saving money by making them more efficient. You're going to be more comfortable by having a house that's more efficient. If you have, you know, a more up-to-date heating system like a heat pump, it's going to be cheaper to operate in the long run. And, you know, there are all these benefits. We were talking to somebody as part of this class about how electric cars will soon cross over to be cheaper than their, you know, the combustion engine cousins, and certainly cheaper to operate. The downside, of course, is mechanics aren't going to be able to charge you as much whenever you pull in, because you won't be pulling in anymore. There's nothing breaks. You might have to change the windshield wipers. You know, that's about it. So this is actually, a lot of these technologies we're replacing the old system with are better in about every other dimension. It's not, this isn't like major sacrifice we're talking about, is it?
No, not at all. And I think that that most individuals would be happy to have a new car or windows that don't leak and cheaper electric bills. I mean, this is not a hard sell. I think that a lot of the opposition is coming from the organizations that will be losing out on revenue. I mean, like you mentioned, taking your car to get serviced. If you have a car that doesn't need as much service, then the organizations, whether it's the dealers or whoever, that might otherwise get that revenue may not be so excited about that solution. So I think that that one of the issues is recognizing that our system has a lot of lobbying organizations and vested interest. And, you know, this isn't a conspiracy theory. It's just the way the world works, is that if you have a new technology that nobody's using yet, that has a lot fewer vested interests than the technology that's been around for 50 years. And so I think trying to think about how we can make change in a way that, you know, make sure that the people who are losing a job or losing revenue can tap into the opportunities of this new economy. And that's an economic issue, a policy issue. It's certainly out of my wheelhouse. But even as a scientist, you know, I know that cause that, you know, you move one thing and there are consequences to that. And so I think that understanding that we can't totally change our economy without recognizing that there will be some winners and losers, and making sure that we're not leaving anybody high and dry as this transition moves forward.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. I mean, change is hard sometimes, and it's disruptive, and there are people who don't like that. But when we make big changes from one kind of economy to another, it's disruptive, and there are going to be winners and losers in the short run. But in the long run, if it's a better technology, we all win if we do it wisely. But the arguments that we can't change technologies because we, you know, some people will be losing something, like that was the argument about, you know, not stopping slavery. You know, there was the argument about, you know, the horseless carriage, you know, kind of thing. It was about getting rid of typewriters with word processors. And some of these were small changes. Some of them were massive, incredible changes we had to undertake. And this is one of those. I mean, this is like a real threat to, you know, the bedrock of society. If we don't address climate change, we're in big trouble. The good news is it's actually going to be good for us when we do it. It's like, I don't know, you know, it's like going to the doctor and hearing the cure for your disease is actually going to make you smarter, better looking, and richer. You know, like, wow, sign me up, you know, whatever, you know, how did I, this is great. I want that HMO, you know, but I don't know. So what do you think about the kind of technological solutions though? Because you work a lot with the energy policy world and kind of see where the trends are, and especially, you know, domestically and internationally, I know you'll think a lot about that. What are some of the most exciting trends you see in pushing these solutions forward?
Well, first I'll just start by saying, you know, you made this comment that solutions to climate change have all these other wins. And a lot of the work that I do actually is focused on the fact that when we have a lower carbon society, we actually will have cleaner air and significant benefits to public health. So I think one of the good things is that almost anything you do to reduce carbon emissions kind of gives you free reductions in nitrogen oxides and ground level ozone and particulates that can limit life expectancy. So, you know, I think one of the nice things is that so many of these changes are win-win, good for climate, good for air quality, good for public health, not to mention saving money often. But when thinking about sort of what are the opportunities that, you know, are right around the corner, to me, energy conservation is one obvious one. Nobody wants to spend more on their electricity. And there's so many ways that we can improve efficiency of our homes, of our electricity use, of our cars and trucks, of our transportation system. And I would say on the technology side, to me, electric cars really are so exciting. And they're exciting not just because they are available and coming down in cost and mean that we don't have to put gas burned into the atmosphere all the time, but they're also exciting because the batteries that are in cars offer the potential to increase solar and wind energy as well. You know, I think one of the things people don't always realize is that, you know, when we use solar energy right now, it's usually when the sun is shining somewhere. And when we use wind energy now, it's because the wind is blowing somewhere. And so one of the big challenges is if we want to use electricity at night, we need a way to store all that solar energy. And these batteries are coming down in price. There's a lot of different interesting ways to store energy. But one of them is if we're all driving cars with big batteries plugged in our garages, then that offers an opportunity for the cars to store up electricity during the day and help us use it at night. And then at night, when we're all asleep, then take some of that wind energy that's blowing in the night and put it back into the car. So I think the electric cars offer that chance to make air quality in cities way cleaner, and also build capacity for expanded renewables in a way that isn't requiring us to add battery storage on a large scale and get the electric cars, but kind of a two-for-one deal with electric cars and supporting renewables.
Is that happening? I mean, just to be clear for our viewer here, what you're saying, I think, is like that, you know, when sometimes during the day when we plug in our electric car, we're buying electricity from our power company to charge up the car. But sometimes they might want to buy it back from us while we're sleeping and not driving our cars. They might suck some of the juice out of our cars for a little while, put it out on the grid because that's when it's needed. And then when we wake up, it puts it back again. It's like kind of buying and selling, you know, current can go in both directions. And so we call like net metering and that kind of thing. Is that what you're talking about? It's like a net metering for cars kind of idea?
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. And it's, I'm not the only one, of course, who's talking about it. It's something that is
a
widespread idea. But to my knowledge, it's not happening yet. And I think in part because of the warranties associated with electric vehicles, and you have to do some manipulation to let them release the battery power back to the grid, and that could void the warranty. So to my knowledge, it's not being done on any large scale, although I'm sure some people have fixed up their car to let it go both ways.
Yeah, it's kind of cool though. And also just the economics of, you know, the fact that, you know, the batteries that are in like a Tesla, at least the original ones, were actually like double A batteries, just thousands and thousands of them.
All right.
Yeah, I think Panasonic was, well, that's what I was told by a Tesla engineer. And so it's like they're leveraging the consumer electronics to get the car electronics, which is making it cheaper for the utility folks to buy big battery storage systems themselves. We're just driving down the cost of all this stuff because we like, you know, batteries are everywhere. Which is kind of cool. And the batteries in your iPhone isn't all that different than the one that we in your car, the one that the utility might buy in principle. So that's kind of cool. One of the things that's really interesting too, though, is about how these technologies can really kind of be deployed in different regions, like, you know, where some solutions make sense in different places. Like, you know, in the Midwest, for example, where you and I are living right now, wind is really, really crucial here. But then you were mentioning kind of like a tidal energy or things like this. Isn't it nice that you can kind of mix and match your electrical distribution and generation to where you live and what your natural resources happen to be?
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I think that this is something that's already happening. There are countries in the world that have a lot of hydropower and mountains. So they can actually pump water up the mountain when they don't need it and let it flow back and form electricity when they do. So yeah, I think that's one of the really exciting things about energy systems in general and electricity in particular, is that you can really harvest your local climate, your local land cover, and your local resources to come up with a low cost regional solution that works for each area.
Yeah. One of the things that people don't really point out very much, but I bet that you've thought about this, is one of the nice things about sunshine and wind is it's kind of more democratic. It's like everybody gets a little bit of it. You know, there are cloudy places and sunnier places, but it's not like oil. Oil is concentrated in a few places in the world, often in places that aren't all that friendly to us or democracy or whatever. Some real, you know, there's some bad actors out there, let's just say that, who are sitting on mounds of oil and gas. Some energy sources are inherently a little bit more democratic because the sun shines a little bit everywhere and the wind blows a little bit everywhere. And you don't have to sit on top of a big, you know, petroleum reserve to have access to energy. All of us get to.
You're absolutely right. And actually, here in my home state of Wisconsin, we don't have any fossil fuels occurring. We have no natural gas, no oil, no coal. And in fact, a couple of years ago, one of my former graduate students, he, as part of his postdoc, calculated how many jobs would be created in Wisconsin if all of our energy came from Wisconsin. And of course, energy coming from Wisconsin means solar, wind, biomass, other sources that we have here in the state, but not fossil fuel. So it's another way of looking at this is through the lens of saying, you know, do we really want to be sending our money someplace else to buy their fossil fuel when we have a lot of natural resources on our own?
Yeah, absolutely. That's one of the great things about climate solutions is that the, you know, the enormous job opportunities it creates, not only production of energy, but all the efficiency measures you talked about. We have, you know, all this like retrofitting of buildings or transportation infrastructure. And those are jobs you can't outsource. These are jobs that AI can't replace. And this is something that could be really good for especially rural states that have been losing some jobs recently. That could be really, really great as we kind of build back the U.S. economy in the coming years. Well, with that, I guess I want to ask one last question is like, what are some of the, talked about the problems, kind of fundamentals of like where there are co-benefits, where some exciting trends are. What do you think is next? If you were advising the next White House, whoever it is, what would you tell them about like, what are the things we should do right now to be really, truly making a difference on climate change? What are the, what should we be telling our elected leaders and business leaders right now that we need to see happen?
Well, that's a really good question, John. And you told me I didn't have to prepare for this interview, but I don't have a little time to think about that one. Because, you know, I think there are so many directions that we could move next. And which one is going to yield the best bang for the buck? Which is going to be the most politically acceptable? You know, that's a really good question. And I guess, you know, I think if I were to say one thing, I guess it would be electric vehicles. And I think one of the reasons is because from my perspective on air quality, cities in America are still suffering from bad ozone and high particulate matter. And it's not every day, but when the weather conditions conspire to be kind of hot and stagnant, those are the times we get really unhealthy ozone smog. And both in the winter and the summer, when we have, you know, the combination of weather conditions that lead to trapping power plant and vehicle emissions over cities, we get high PM. And so I think that when I think about solutions, I'm especially excited about the climate solutions that will make the air cleaner where people are living and breathing. And most people live in cities, they're dense populated areas, but that means there's also lots and lots of cars and trucks and buses that are all happening there. And these environments offer the perfect place to be rolling out more electric vehicles and public transportation options, but and walkable cities. I mean, there's so many different ways because nobody likes driving their car and being stuck in traffic. Nobody likes filling up at the gas station. And these urban environments are places where we can charge electric vehicles more easily. We can locate where we live closer to where we work. We can do more telecommuting. And if there's one thing that the COVID crisis has shown us is that there's a lot of things we can do from home that we may not have thought of before. So, you know, to me, focusing on cities and reducing transportation emissions offers so many benefits. There's so many ways to go about it. And, you know, there's not, as you've said over the years, one silver bullet, but there's a lot of solutions that can be combined together. And I think, I guess I would focus on transportation in urban areas as a immediate win with so many different strategies to support it.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a really good point. Well, thank you, Tracey, for spending a little time with us today. This has been really fun and really illuminating. So thank you so much.